Start today's session. Okay, so today we will discuss Gauss elimination method, and what we will do, we will take one example, solve manually, and while solving manually we will simultaneously prepare its flowchart, so that flowchart will give you an idea how the understanding about the method will be converted to prepare a flowchart. Then that flowchart will be problem specific, means the problem which we'll be solving here, for that problem we are writing the flowchart. And then we will discuss another flowchart, how we can prepare a generalized flowchart, so that if there is a change in example or new example is there, you can use the generalized flowchart to prepare Python code and solve the problem. Okay, so with this I will start the example. So the problem is, apply Gauss elimination method to solve the equations. So three equations are given in this problem, and there are three unknowns, x, y and z. So you can say that three equations, three unknowns means you can find out the solution. Then the first step in the Python is to start the Python. Either you can use Colab or any appropriate tool. For example, on my system I installed Anaconda, and I will be using Jupyter file for writing the code. Then when a problem is given to you, the first step is to convert that equations into a matrix of the form AX is equal to B. So A is a coefficient matrix, X is unknown matrix, and B is the matrix for the elements which is given on right sides of the equation. So you have two options. You can write AX equal to B, or you can write augmented matrix. So in augmented matrix, there will be three rows and four columns. That fourth column will be related to matrix B. Okay, so in Gauss elimination method, we know that we need to convert the given matrix, for example, A in this case, in upper triangular matrix, means you need to make all the elements below the main diagonal to zero. So in this particular question, you need to convert these elements to zero by performing row operations. So this particular matrix AX is equal to B, that you need to define in Python. So once you start the Python, you need to define matrix A, which is coefficient matrix, and B, which is on right side, that is minus 5, 12, minus 12 and 4, these are the elements. Also you can define an unknown matrix X as well. Then we know that we perform row operations first in order to make these two elements to zero, that is 1 and 3 to 0. And for that we use pivoting point as the first element of your main diagonal. So 1. So which operations will you perform? You will perform R2 minus R1. R2 minus R1. If you do that, you can convert the first element below the main diagonal element 1 to 0. And similarly, you will get new values for remaining elements of the second row. Similarly, in order to make the third element of column number 1 to 0, you will perform R3 minus 3R1, so that you can see the third row out of which first element is 0, and after performing that operation you will see the new values for second, third element of matrix A and third element of matrix B. So this is how by performing row operations on row number 2 and row number 3, we converted the second and third element of column number 1 to 0, where the 1 is your pivoting point. And while performing this particular operation, you need to make sure that this 1, that is diagonal elements, is non-zero. So this particular value, that is 1, is your diagonal, but that you need to make sure that it is not equal to 0. If this value is equal to 0, then what you need to do, you need to interchange the first row with second row or first row with third row, so that this pivoting point will be non-zero. This is very important thing you need to remember. Then you need to write the codes in order to perform these operations. So in order to make these two elements to zero, you perform R2-R1 and R3-3R1. So that you need to write as step number 4, and in Python you need to write appropriate codes for the same. Then after completion of step number 1, you need to make this minus 13, that is second element of third row, to 0. And for that you can use minus 3 as pivoting point. And for that we will perform row operations on row number 3, and that operation is R3 minus 13 upon 3 R2. So if you perform this operation, you can see that below pivoting point, that is minus 3, the element becomes 0, and you will get new values for third element of third row and third element of matrix B. So these are the new values assigned or carried based on estimation. So in Python again, when you do this operation, you need to make sure that the second pivoting point, that is minus 3, should be non-zero. So that you need to check, and appropriately you need to write down the code in Python. And if it is 0, you need to interchange the second and third row, not first and second. You need to interchange second and third row, and after that you can perform the operation, that is row operations, in order to make the second element of third row to 0. And appropriate code you need to write down in the Python. Then when you look at the new matrix, then you can easily say that if you use third row, you can calculate the value of Z. Then by using row number 2, you can calculate value of Y, and by using first row, you can calculate the value of X. Let's see how it is done. So from third row, the equation is 71 upon 3Z equal to 148 upon 3. Upon simplification, you will get value of Z as 2.0845. So this is the answer for Z. Now we will use second row, and the equation is 0x minus 3y minus 5z equal to minus 7. So this is the equation that you get from row number 2, and we know the value of Z, and we are interested in value of Y. So rewrite this equation in terms of Y and put the value of Z into the equation, and upon simplification you will get value of Y as minus 1.1408. So this is how you will get value of Y. Then from first row you can prepare this equation, 1x plus 4y minus Z equal to minus 5. So this will be the equation, and from this equation you know the value of Y and Z. So write the equation, X is equal to, and then whatever will be the terms on right side, put the value of y as well as z. And once you do that, you can simplify that equation in order to get the value of x. And here x is 1.6477. So hence you will get the solution of that equation. X is equal to 1.6477, y equal to minus 1.1408, and z is equal to 2.0845. This process is called as back substitution. And in the flowchart, you need to write down the codes or the steps accordingly. So we were at this step. So next step is back substitution. So use third row to prepare this equation. Use second row to prepare this equation, and use first row to prepare third equation. So we prepare this equation, simplify those equations. So for that, you need to write the codes in the Python. And whatever you will be getting the value of x, y, z, you can print those value, and that will be the solution. That will be the end of your program. So when you look at this particular flowchart, this particular flowchart is prepared for the example that we just solved. But when a general question will be there, there will not be only 3x3 matrix. It may be 4x4 or n x n matrix. So that change will be there. Whatever row operations you will be performing, that will be different for based on the elements. And also you need to apply this condition, that is, you need to make sure that all the diagonal elements are non-zero. So that you need to consider. And based on that, you can write general equation and corresponding flowchart. So first step will be start, then define matrix A and B of AXB, where the size of matrix A will be n x n, whatever will be the value of n. Then next step will be you need to convert matrix A to upper triangular matrix, and for that purpose you need to perform the steps which is given in the dashed box. So in that, first you need to make sure that the A11, that is the first element of your main diagonal, if it is equal to 0. If yes, you need to interchange first and second row, or first and third row, or first and next row, so that A11 will not be equal to 0. Then once you do that, once you make sure that A11 is not equal to 0, then perform row operations. And while performing, you need to make sure that in column number 1, all the elements below A11 will be converted to 0. Accordingly, you need to perform the row operations. Then once you did it, then you need to go to second column, and in that pivoting point will be A22, and you need to check whether A22 equal to 0, and if it is yes, then you need to interchange second and third row, or second and fourth row, or any two rows, so that A22 will be non-zero. Once you assure that this particular diagonal element is non-zero, you need to perform row operations so that all the elements below this pivoting point will be converted to 0. And this is how you can complete this particular step. Then you need to go to A33, A44, A55, and just perform such type of operations so that ultimately you will be converting the matrix A to upper triangular form. And once the matrix will be converted to upper triangular form, you need to do back substitution to calculate the value of x, y, z, then u will be there, then v will be there, and all other elements, because this matrix is of n by n type. Then print all the values x, y, z, and whatever remaining values will be there, and that will be the solution of the given simultaneous equation. So this is the end of your generalized flowchart. Now what we will do, we will see how we can write a program for the generalized flowchart so that we can solve the problem, any type of problem. Okay, so in this case, you can see the first step is you need to start the Python. So I already installed Anaconda version on my system. So I will open a Jupyter notebook. When you click on it, Jupyter notebook will open and a localhost you can see on your screen. Then click on new, where you will find an option Python 3. Click on that. You will see a new window where you can write the code. So in my previous last week, I made an announcement on the Google Classroom that you need to understand how, you need to learn how to prepare matrix in Python, how to perform various operations in the Python. So I hope you did it. And based on that assumption, we will start our today's session. Okay, so just like previous problem, you need to write some comments at the beginning. For example, your name, your roll number, your class, name of the program, whatever you want to say, right? Okay. Then next step is you need to define matrix A and matrix B, or you can also define the unknown matrix, that is X. And as we are going to perform row operations and on the matrix, that is array, because matrix is an array, so you need to import certain libraries so that Python will understand what type of operations you want to do, and that library will help you to perform that operation. So here we will import NumPy as np. This particular library is used for array processing, because in the program you are expecting to carry out certain row operations. Then we will also import a module sys, and we will see how this particular command is used. Especially there are certain situations where you need to come out of the exit the program, so for that we will use this particular module. Then in order to define matrix A and B, we don't know what is the size of the matrix, because we are going to solve any kind of problem that will have 1 by 1 matrix or n by n, we don't know. So what we will do, we will first of all make it generalized that the matrix is of n by n. So, and if n by n matrix will be there, means there will be n number of unknowns. So we will write a line for that. N is equal to int, and here we will input enter number of unknowns. So this particular line will help you to enter the value of number of unknowns. So when you try to run this particular program, you can check the given problem, how many unknowns are there, and with the help of this line, you can enter number of unknowns. And the number of unknowns are always integer, so we put the data type as int. Then for the given number of unknowns, first of all, you need to make a blank or empty matrix of size n by n. Or if you want to form an augmented matrix that we are going to do here, in that case, there will be n number of rows and columns will be n plus 1. Why n plus 1? That plus 1 is additional column for the matrix B. and this is how you will get augmented matrix A. So A is equal to NP for NumPy, and to define a empty matrix we will use zeros and N comma N plus 1. So this is how you can define an empty matrix A that will have N number of rows and N plus 1 number of columns. Similarly, we will define the unknown matrix which will be of size N by 1. Okay, so this is how you define matrix A and B, but these matrix are empty. So what you need to do, you need to write certain lines so that at output window you can enter the values of matrix A. So see how I'm doing it. For I in range N, and for J in range N plus 1. So I'm defining certain values to I and J, and then we will assign values to each elements of the matrix. So this is how this is how you can assign the values to each element of the matrix, and the values may be float, generally float, because we are going to perform certain operations. And you can use input command to enter the values. So you need to enter the values very carefully here. So for that I am writing the lines. So see carefully how I am defining the same. You should be very careful about what you are typing, because generally during typing, when you want to write something and due to spelling mistake you write something else. So you need to make sure that whatever you are writing, it is correct one. Yeah, there is also a chance that afterwards if there is a error occur to a line, modify that and you can do it. So line number 8, 9 and 10 will be used for defining the elements of matrix. So this is how A in box I, box J means, if we put I equal to 0, J equal to 0 means that will be the first row, first column element, and so on. So I will take values N, first value will be 0 and last value will be N value, and for J the first value will be 0 and last value will be N plus 1. So when you look at I and J values, you can easily guess that I will be used for defining a row element and J will be used to define column element, because number of rows are equal to N and number of columns is equal to N plus 1. That additional one column is there for augment matrix B. So this is how using line number 8, 9, 10, we define or we entered the value of matrix elements. Okay, so then we will enter into this loop and we need to perform these operations so that it will make sure that the diagonal elements are non-zero, and also it will perform row operations in order to make the value, the elements below the pivoting point will be zero. So for that, I will write the next line. Again, for that, we will write for lines for loop. So here you might have realized that many times I'm using for loop, and that range is often expressed in terms of number of unknowns. Why? Because for loop is helpful to carry out repetitive operations, and the number of unknowns, that is n, will help you to define the element of a given row and given column. So for that purpose, we are writing this particular program. Then we will write the next line, that is, if a I equal to zero. See, when we entered into the loop, the first operation was we need to make sure that the diagonal element should be non-zero. So this particular line will make sure that this particular element is non-zero. So if this condition is true, then now we will use that module SYS. So SYS dot exit. Divided by zero is detected. So if one of the element, that is AII equal to, that is diagonally, if it is equal to zero, then we need to come out of the program. Okay. So that's why we write this equation. You can write this particular line in your own way by using your own code in order to make it generalized. So that is also one option available, and you can do that. Then if this particular element is non-zero, then we will write next line, that is, we'll define tail elements using for loop. And here we will write I plus 1 and n. So the starting value of I will be 0, and the starting value of j will be I plus 1, that is 1. And again, last element also will be same. Then in order to perform, so we completed this particular condition. Now we will perform row operations, and we need to define it very general manner, because you can see here. Yeah, you can see here. Here we perform R2 minus R1 because the first column, second element is 1, and first element, first column is also 1. So this is simple way, but in order to make this 3 as 0, we perform different operations, R3 minus 3, R1, because the third element and the first element will have different value. So for every operations, you need to perform multiplied value, that is a ratio. So what we will do, we will define that operation in a generalized way, so that any value will be there for pivoting point or corresponding element of which we need to make the value 0. So we will make it very general. So that we will do in two steps. First step, we will find out the ratio, and that ratio will have a j into I, and which is divided by a I. Yeah. So generally what you do when you perform some operations, when you want to make this element zero, what you do, you multiply the first row by this particular value, this particular element, that is one in this case, and divide it by the element which is here. So same thing we are writing as a zero, and then we will perform that row operation, for example R2 by R1. So first of all we will calculate that ratio, for example AJI divided by AII. And once you do that, you can now perform that row operations. And that operations you need to make a very generalized. So we will again use loop for. So for k in range n plus 1, and now you can find out new values, all the new values for second row, third row and upcoming rows by using this particular line AJK, which is equal to AJK minus ratio. In previous line we calculated the value of ratio, multiplied by AIK. Okay, so this is how you made it very generalized in order to convert the given matrix to upper triangular form. So I will just checking the lines. Yeah, so from line number 11 to 17, what you did, you just tried to convert the given matrix into upper triangular matrix. So these are the lines for the same. So what may happen, there is a chance that you made some mistake. So when you execute this particular program, at that time you will come to know whether you did any mistake or not. Okay, so we write a loop for executing this dashed box, all the commands given in it. Then we will go to back substitution in order to calculate x1, x2, x3 up to xn, or x, y, z, u, v, whatever the n number of value. So we will write the line for the same. But before that, I will show you something. When you go for back substitution by using third row, you can directly calculate the value of z. You can check the third row, you can easily get the value of z. Then we go to second last row to calculate the value of y. Then we go to third last row in order to calculate the value of x. So this process is in a reverse order. So you need to make sure that you are writing the codes and you are going in a reverse order in the matrix. So x n minus 1 is equal to a n minus 1 into n, and it is divided by a n minus 1 n minus 1. So this particular line we can write for calculating the value of last unknown. So in this case the last unknown is z, and for that we will use third row. And same line we try to reflect in a generalized manner, so that whatever will be the last unknown, it will be calculated. And then we will slowly move in a reverse order, that is last row to second last and third last and so on, in order to calculate the unknowns. And for that again we will use for loop. So I in range n minus 2, this is the starting value, last value will be minus 1, and steps will be minus 1. So last unknown we already calculated, so we want to calculate the second last unknown, and that's why we, and slowly we will go to n minus 3 n minus 4, so that minus 1, so that we will go in a reverse order, and the steps will be defined by this minus 1. So nth row, then previous n minus 1th row, and that step will be minus 1. That's, this is how we define our for loop. Then we will write a code for equations, because first you get the equations from the matrix, then you simplify that equation, first of all convert it into y is equal to, then put the values and get the solution. So we'll try to convert this into a code. So how? See here. So xi, this is the second last element that in which we are interested, which is equal to a, and I n. So this is how you can write the first line. And again you need to use for loop, because we are using two times for loop, because we need to define the row position and column position in order to go to the exact value of that element. So for j in range, and that range will be I plus 1, and the last value will be n. So you can easily see the difference between the these two. One is expressed in other, especially j will use the value of I. Then we will write next line, xi is equal to xi minus a into bracket I j multiplied by x j, and x I will be equal to x I divided by x I. So this is how we perform certain steps for back substitution. So these are the lines to our back substitution. First of all, with the help of line 18, we calculate the last unknown, and by using that last value and to estimate all the remaining values, we define for loop. So from line number 19 to 23, these are the codes used for back substitution and calculating the unknowns. Once you get the unknown values, you need to print it. So for that we'll use command print and slash n. The solution is, and again to print all the unknowns, we again use for loop. So you might have realized that for loop is very important in such type of problem. So there are so many links that I provided on your Google Classroom. You can use those to understand how this particular loop, that is for loop, is executed or used for solving different problems. So x percent d is equal to percent 0.4 f to define accuracy, then percent into bracket I comma xi comma int equal to slash t. Okay, so this particular line, that is line number 26, is the typical format that we are going to use to print the value of unknowns, that is x, y, z, or x naught, x1, x2, in case of n number of unknowns. So this is how we prepared a code by using a generalized flowchart, but we are not sure that whether we appropriately converted this particular flowchart into code. So when you start executing the program, if you did any mistake, it will show you as an error. So let's try. We will run this program. Now it is saying that the for loop of line number 19, I range n minus 2 minus 1 minus 1, invalid syntax. So let us check what is the problem. So for I in range, so we did that mistake. Now we'll check once again. Yeah, now it's working. Because see what happens when you try to write the code by using flowchart, during typing you may do some mistakes. So when you run this program, it will tell you at which line error is and what type of error is, and from that you can understand how to overcome that error. Okay, so it is asking number of unknown. So it is related to line number 5, you can see in the program. And we will check whether the program is correct or not, and for that this particular exam we will take once again. So in this program problem, 3 equations, 3 unknowns. So number of unknowns 3. Now it is asking A00, so the programming is coming to line number 10. So whatever you wrote from line number 6 to line number 10, now it is executing. So up to line number 10, all the codes are correct, and you need to enter the values. So we'll enter the values. So how to enter? As we are entering the values as a augmented matrix, and all the elements from first row you need to enter, then from second row, then third row, and so on. So first row 1, 4, minus 1, minus 5. So 1, 4, minus 1, minus 5. So we entered the element from row 1. Then from second row, so 1, 1, minus 6, minus 12. So 1, 1, minus 6, minus 12. Then 3, minus 1, minus 1, 4. 3, minus 1, minus 1, 4. Okay, so when you look at these values, it is showing the location, that is the index. For example, 1 has index A11 when we say matrix, and it is here showing A00. So instead of A11, we are starting from A00. Nothing is different. Then yeah, now it is showing error once again. So what type of error it is showing? Line number 23 and invalid index to scalar variable. So we'll go to line number 23. Here it is showing error. So we will check that what type of error it is. Yeah, can anybody tell what type of error it could be? Here everything is given here. Invalid index to scalar. You can Google it, no problem. Xi equal to Xi divided by, oh here we put X, so actually here we are expected to write a matrix. X is an element, right? So we did that modification. Let's check. We run the program again, number of unknowns 3. Again we will put elements 1, 4, minus 1, minus 5, 1, 4, minus 1, minus 5, then 1, 1, minus 6, minus 12, 1, 1, minus 6, minus 12, and lastly 3 minus 1 minus 1, 4. 3 minus 1 minus 1, 4. Okay, let's see. Yeah, it's showing some answer. And what answer it is? 135 minus 36 minus 4. And our answers are different, right? So program is working, but answer is wrong. Means what is happening? Whatever you write from line number 10 to line number 26, the formulae that you entered have some mistakes. And you need to check very carefully in order to execute the program correctly and get the correct solution. Okay, so we will check the program once again. And we will see what to do. Okay, for I in range n, it seems correct. Then we are checking if AI equal to 0. Yes, it is also seems correct. Then for here what we did, after if this particular condition will be executed. Now if this is not true, then we need to run this particular code separately. For given indent, whatever indent we provided here, it is working just below the if loop, so it is becoming a part of that if loop, so we need to take out that. So I'm just changing the indent so that appropriate execution will be done. Okay, now I hope everything is correct. I will run it once again. Number of unknowns 3. We'll check the elements. 1, 4, minus 1, minus 5. 1, 4, minus 1, minus 5. 1, 1, minus 6, minus 12, 1, 1, minus 6, minus 12, 3, minus 1, minus 1, 4, 3, minus 1, minus 1, 4, I hope I'm correct, I entered correct values, okay. Now we'll check solution. Yeah, it's showing 2, minus 1, 2, okay, we'll check. X naught is 2. Okay, hope this is the value. And next is x1 is minus 1. Yeah. And x3 is 2. Okay, it seems that the values are correct but printed in a reverse order. So we need to change that line, or you can do it afterwards. But yeah, these are the correct values program is showing. Just modification of the x0, x1, x2. So what you need to do, you need to modify one of the line, especially the way you are printing here. If you did it, it will be fine. So this is how we removed the error in the program and executed in order to get the solution of the problem. Okay, so that's it for this problem. If you have any question, our session is open for discussion.